Hello everyone, I am Giovanni Tambalo, a postdoc in the Albert Einstein Institute in Potsdam, and today I will talk about beyond perturbation theory in inflation. So this project was in collaboration with Marco Celoria, Paolo Criminelli, and Vicerit Yingchen Rat, and appeared a few months ago on the archive. So before starting, I want to thank the organizers for the opportunity of presenting at this conference. So this is the outline of my presentation. So first of all, I will discuss what we mean by perturbation theory in inflation. Then I will move to why we need to go beyond perturbation theory, and I will explain how we can do so in an example in quantum mechanics. And then I will move to the relevant case of inflation. And finally, I will end with conclusions and the future directions. So we all know that inflation is a period of early accelerated expansion of the universe. And typically this is described by an inflaton phi rolling down its potential. And the potential is assumed to be very flat so that the expansion is approximately a de Sitter expansion, so that the metric at first order is given by the metric of de Sitter, given here in terms of the conformal time eta. So the situation is very interesting when we look at perturbations. And in this talk, we will consider only scalar perturbations parameterized by this zeta appearing in the metric in this form. And of course, these perturbations are generated quantum mechanically. And as we all know, they freeze once they cross the Hubble horizon. And so the power spectrum for zeta, or the two-point correlation function, is given by p zeta over k to the 3, giving the famous scale invariant power spectrum. And on CMB scales, we know that the power spectrum should be of order 10 to the minus 10, corresponding to values of zeta that are very small, of the order of 10 to the minus 5. So this is the Gaussian picture. So when we consider only quadratic terms for zeta in the action, but of course we can consider also non-Gaussianities for zeta, but these are very, very suppressed. And we can see this as follows. So non-Gaussianities are parameterized by the three-point function, the four-point function, and so on. And if zeta takes typical values of the order of the power spectrum to the 1/2, then these corrections to non-Gaussianities are of this form and can be written in this way in terms of FNL, which is describing the non-Gaussianity of the three-point function. And experimentally, this quantity is bounded to be less than 10 to the minus 3. So correction to Gaussianity are indeed very small. So because of this, one can study reliably correction to Gaussianity in perturbation theory. So one can use, for instance, the so-called informalism and compute expectation value of some operator Q. And the expression for this formula is given by this expression. And as we can see, the Hamiltonian can be expanded in terms of the couplings of the theory in a perturbative fashion. And another important point is that we have to project at early times on the vacuum. And to do so, we need to slightly deform the contour of integration in the conformal time and add an imaginary part. So this will be relevant later on. So what I said before is actually valid only for typical fluctuations of zeta. But in general, when we look at, for instance, the probability distribution of zeta on the tails, this expansion might break down. And to see this, we can look at the schematic form for the probability distribution of zeta. And we see that the correction to Gaussianity, which are these corrections containing the three-point function, the four-point function, and so on, they do depend on zeta. So if zeta becomes very large, this quantity can overcome the Gaussian part. And so the perturbative expansion has to break down. In other words, this condition can be written like this. So FNL times zeta of order one means that the perturbative expansion breaks down. So when we look at the probability distribution and when zeta is larger than one over FNL, then we need some other method to compute the probability distribution. And we cannot trust the perturbative expansion we were discussing before. So this thesis of the distribution can be relevant, for instance, for primordial black hole formation, where the abundance of primordial black holes is highly sensitive to the thesis of the probability distribution. And in particular, the formation of primordial black holes depends on configuration of zeta that exceed some threshold that is, let's say, of order one, which is much larger than the typical values given by the power spectrum of zeta. So more concretely, this discussion that we just had can be relevant for primordial black holes in models in which FNL is quite large. So let's say of order 100 or of order 10. So in slow roll models, this does not happen since FNL is highly suppressed. So in the following, we will consider models of inflation with large non-Gaussianities, such as K-inflation or models with derivative interactions. Okay, so how do we go about and compute the tail of the probability distribution? Well, we can realize that the tail is amenable to a semi-classical calculation. And we can realize this by looking at what happens in the limit of h bar going to zero. So in this limit, fluctuations, quantum fluctuations go to zero, so they are stuck at zero. So intuitively, this limit should describe unlikely events, or in other words, should describe the tail of the probability distribution. More formally, we can see this by looking at the wave function for zeta, which is related in this way to the probability distribution. The wave function can be written as a path integral over configurations of zeta going from the Banks-Davis vacuum to some late time configuration zeta zero. And in the limit of small h bar, we have that the action over h bar must become very large. And so we are in a semi-classical regime in which we can essentially approximate this integral with a relevant configuration. And in other words, we just write the wave function as the exponential of I action. So we just need at this point a classical configuration interpolating between the Banks-Davis and this late time configuration. And in this way, we can reliably evaluate the tail of the distribution for zeta. And we can discuss this also in quantum mechanics, so we can have a better understanding of what's going on. So in quantum mechanics, we can be interested, for instance, in the ground state wave function, psi zero of some particle in some one-dimensional potential. So if we rotate to Euclidean time, there is an expression similar to the one of the previous slide for the wave function in terms of a path integral given by this expression. And since we are interested in the ground state, we are basically selecting the energy equal to zero configurations. So if the configuration we are interested in, so if the position is xf is very large, then we are on the tail of the distribution or on the tail of the wave function. And the semi-classical limit can be applied. In this limit, the wave function will scale like e to the minus se, where se is the Euclidean action given here. And you can notice that the Euclidean action has a different sign for the potential. So what we are looking for is a configuration that interpolates between some initial and final positions in an inverted potential. So more concretely, we can consider an anharmonic potential in which we have the usual harmonic part plus a quartic anharmonicity. And we have this small parameter lambda. So the typical perturbation theory is done by expanding in lambda. But we can realize that even if lambda is small, if you're interested in positions or on the tail of the distribution for the particle, very far away from the origin, then this contribution in the potential can become of the same order as this. And so we have a classical or semi-classical parameter given by this X bar that depends both on lambda and XF. And when this parameter becomes of order one, we cannot trust the perturbation theory anymore, since perturbation theory would tell you that this parameter is small, so it's an expansion in lambda. Whereas now we are keeping lambda small, but X bar fixed. So if you are interested in the zero energy configuration, we can easily find the value of the action on shell. And indeed, in quantum mechanics, this just corresponds into solving a simple integral. And we can write the action in the following fashion. So it's it will scale like 1 over lambda times a function of this semi-classical parameter x bar. And we can see that this function of x bar is, in a way, non-perturbative in lambda. Indeed, we have a non-integer exponent for x bar. And as we can see, this quantity is very different from the usual quadratic expression that we would have in the free theory. So the wave function will be written in this way. So it will be the exponent of the action, and the part of the action is enhanced by this 1 over lambda, whereas loop corrections, or corrections that we neglected in this semi-classical approximation, will be subdominant in a series in lambda. But they can depend on this parameter X bar. So with this example, now we can move on to the case of inflation, and the story will be very similar. So for instance, we specify a particular model for inflation, for the perturbation zeta, and we consider a usual quadratic part for zeta in the action, and we add a nonlinear interaction of this kind that depends on derivatives of zeta and has a small coupling lambda that we assume again to be very small. This model was introduced in this paper, and the reason why we consider this model is that it's relatively simple, so we can do some analytic estimate as well as numerical studies. And furthermore, it contains derivative interactions of zeta, so that this derivatives interaction will die off at late times, and so they will be relevant basically only at horizon crossing. And this somehow simplifies the analysis that we have to do. So in this case, the classical nonlinear parameter is given by this zeta zero tilde, that again depends on lambda and also on zeta. And in particular, zeta zero here represents the value of zeta at late times. So it's the late time configuration that we choose for zeta. And this is the analogous of X bar in quantum mechanics. So in the semi-classical expansion, we expect that the action will scale again as 1 over lambda times a function of this zeta zero tilde. And essentially, our goal is to figure out what is this function appearing here. So in order to figure out this function, we need to first solve the classical equations of motion for zeta with prescribed boundary conditions. And in particular, we want to go to Euclidean space again. Since in Euclidean space, these equations become elliptic, and so they are easier to solve numerically. So the conditions that we choose are the following. So we choose Banks-Davis initial conditions, and at late times, instead, we consider a configuration for zeta that actually we choose a configuration that is spherically symmetric and with a very large value for zeta zero, in such a way that we are in this limit where the semi-classical approximation is reliable. And we choose this spherical configuration because this is mostly relevant for primordial black holes. So people in primordial black hole studies typically choose spherical configurations. And here we can see some numerical results. So some profiles for zeta in time and space for different nonlinear parameters. So we can see that as we increase the nonlinear parameter, the solution deviates more and more from the free case, which is this black line. So once we have these classical configurations, we can evaluate the action. And to do so, we just need to plug the solution back into the action and perform an integral over space and time. But there is an issue in contrast with quantum mechanics. And the issue arises at the level of the free action. And this issue is actually the fact that in the sitter, there are divergences in the action that go like 1 over tau f, where tau f is the final time at which we, let's say, we end our evolution. But we can notice that this divergence corresponds to a phase when we go to Lorentzian time. So when we rotate back to Lorentzian, this gives an I, and so it represents a phase. So when we discuss the probability distribution of zeta, which is just the modulus squared of the wave function, this phase will disappear. So it's not relevant for our discussion. So what we do is just to subtract this irrelevant phase from our results. And in this way, even at the nonlinear level, the action remains finite. So at this point, we can analytically estimate what is the expected behavior of the action as a function of this nonlinear parameter. And we realize that it should go like zeta zero tilde to the 3/2. And this is actually supported by the numerical estimates that we did. So by solving the classical equations of motion for different late time configurations, we can figure out the scaling of the action. And this indeed matches with the analytical estimates. So in the end, we can conclude that the distribution for zeta will be highly different from the Gaussian probability distribution. And in this case of this interaction is actually less suppressed at large zeta zero in comparison with the Gaussian distribution. So at this point, I can go to the conclusion of this discussion. So we discussed that the tail of the probability distribution for zeta are not amenable to a perturbative calculation. So what we can do instead is to use a semi-classical approach and study these tails. And in particular, we studied a particular model in which nonlinearities are relatively simple, and we could estimate both analytically and numerically the dependence of the wave function. So there are also future directions at this point that we are exploring, one of which is to explore different models, again with large non-Gaussianities, that can be interesting for instance, for primordial black holes formation. So for instance, K-inflation, DBI, inflation, and other models. And finally, we would like to more systematically study the production of primordial black holes in light of these results on the probability distribution for zeta. So with this, I thank you for your attention, and I hope to answer your question in the discussion session.